Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, wherever you are, whatever you're doing, and welcome to another episode of Media Matters by Anfield Index. It's interesting this morning, isn't it? As Liverpool secure a draw in St James's Park, some see it as 2 points dropped, some see it as a point gained. Basically, Liverpool Twitter seems to be at war this morning, but we are still top of the league and we are still 7 points clear. I'm joined as ever by the renowned and respected David Lynch. And David, I know you did your pod last night and you've had a bit of time to sort of sit on it, let it digest. How are you seeing this right now?
Yeah, I totally understand that the frustration around when you kind of throw it away that late on, it's really hard to stomach. And but I think sometimes you just have to, you know, it's stupid not to kind of consider the wider context. And the fact is that Liverpool, you know, coming off the back of a tough week, going away to Newcastle is hard anyway. It's another one of those stormy weather. You know, I know that sounds daft to, you know, but they speak about this all the time. That makes away games more difficult. You know, if you're against a team that can be direct, the conditions don't help. And, you know, coming into that, and it is a tough game. You know, Arsenal lose there, Man City drop points there. They've beaten Chelsea as well, I believe, this season. I think that's right. So it's a really, really tough game. And I thought Liverpool, for large stages of it, were kind of outplayed. And so the fact that they took something out of it, I think, is kind of worthy of celebration a little bit. And I think, you know, I don't know whether sometimes people thought that you get the point, the gap's 9 points at the top, and that it's just going to stay that way until the end of the season. But the reason that you're happy about there being a gap is that it does allow you to drop points here and there. And you know, you aren't going to win every game between now and the end of the season. So if you have a situation like this where you don't play your best, it's a tough place to go, and you come away with something, that is worthwhile and not the worst thing that can happen in the world. And I did have this down as a game where Liverpool could potentially drop points. And there will be more, by the way, between now and the end of the season. We need to get our heads around that. So if one of the ones where you drop points is Newcastle away and it's a tough game where you don't play your best and you were 5 minutes away from winning it, by the way, then, you know, sometimes you just have to accept it. And I thought there were, you know, loads of positives still to take from the game. But yes, a few negatives. But I think a lot of those are mitigated by the circumstances. Like I said, the week that Liverpool had had, the fact that Newcastle had had a free week in the build-up while Liverpool were playing Real Madrid, they were obviously fresher. You could see that. And still, Liverpool showed, I thought, at times, great spirit to even get back into it. And you know, they created quite a few chances themselves. And, you know, if they'd got a few more breaks in their favour, they could have quite easily won that game. So it's just one of those for me. And as I said, I think the main takeaway has to be that you have to drop points somewhere. You don't win every game between now and the end of the season. And so if you look at this, it doesn't feel like a big waste to drop points at Newcastle away, particularly as Arsenal, who looked like Liverpool's main title rivals, did lose this game. So you've just got to kind of take the positives, I think, and not get overwhelmed by the negative ending to the game, or, you know, the fact the performance wasn't perfect, because that is going to happen a few more times across the rest of this season.
Yeah. And to be fair, I know people will think about the Kelleher decision, the Shaw goal as a last minute thing, but a point at St James's Park isn't bad. And I did want to ask you about this, because I think a lot of people clock the contrast between the first and the second half really couldn't have been any different for me personally, but maybe, just maybe, Curtis Jones sums it up best. So let's see what he said last night.
Move on.
I was going to say, given how the first half went and the position you find yourself in, do you leave thinking this might be a decent point, or do you reflect on the fact that you'd wrestled it back, had yourself in front with so little time to go that you should have seen it out?
I think a team like us now have played, and you know, the teams that we've beat, I think we have to win these games. Again, you know, it's a hard place to come and play. You know, they're a good team, they've got great fans, and you know, it helps them as well. So yeah, you know, again, you know, the first half, it was tough. I thought we were, you know, we were terrible. And then we upped it again in the second half. I scored it, changed the whole of the game, and was back in. So yeah, you know, I'm gutted that we couldn't take all 3 points, but you know, we'll take a point, that's fine.
Pretty honest, as you probably expected with Curtis Jones as well. Described the first half as terrible, but obviously talked about the second half and how his goal sort of changed it. Agree with those sentiments completely?
Yeah, I think he's right. I thought that first half, it just kind of felt like Liverpool were falling into the same traps over and over. And the amount of times that Gravenberch got his pocket picked in that deeper midfield role, just kind of Liverpool firing passes into him, not kind of realising that Newcastle is set up for this. They want you to do that. They want to isolate Gravenberch and they want to get him. And that's not criticism of him and his performance, by the way. It was, it's the setup and it's what you're doing, and you've got to kind of be a bit smarter in situations like that. But also, as I say, you've also got to kind of acknowledge that Newcastle probably understandably have more energy in these moments, and Liverpool not quite at the sharpest after what they've had to put in over this period. So, I agree. I thought that the first half performance wasn't very good for various reasons. And, Liverpool kind of come in at half time and thinking it probably could have been worse than it was, really, the situation. So, what I think that kind of leads into what was one of the big positives is that the second half was much, much better, wasn't it? I thought, particularly in terms of the threat Liverpool themselves carried, because I think they never really fully got on top of controlling Newcastle and make them being dangerous. And that's, again, sometimes that's going to happen to you in games, but they were actually their football in terms of playing out and being dangerous and created chances was much better in the second half, and kind of a much more even game in that second half, really. And that, again, is another reason that if you give up half the game in the way that Liverpool did, you kind of come away thinking, okay, a point's not too bad, and throwing in all that other mitigation that I mentioned earlier. And it was a vastly improved second half performance. And I think performance-wise, you can kind of come away and just think, okay, well, there were good elements there that they'll take forward. We haven't seen a lot of the negative elements so far. It's going to happen. Just take those positives and move on. And I think that's the way that the team will be treating it. I don't think Arne Slot will be conducting an investigation or an inquest into this one. I just think it's kind of, he'll know some of those things went wrong. He'll be happy with the elements that they were able to fix in the second half and just kind of move on from a tough game with the point that you end up with. Especially feeling that you could have had more as well, were it not for kind of one individual error at the end, which you can't really mitigate for. So, I thought Curtis kind of summed it up perfectly there, really, in terms of how the performance was split into the two halves.
Yeah, Arne Slot was similar in his situation, as was mentioned, to be fair. Newcastle having the extra 24 hours of that extra recovery time, and I do think it really played a part on that. Arne Slot was also asked about Mo Salah, and we're going to wax lyrical very shortly, but let's just listen to what he actually said specifically when asked about Mo Salah last night.
Yeah, it's difficult for me to predict the future, but the long-term future, the only thing I can expect or predict is that he's in a very good place at the moment. He plays in a very good team that provides him with good opportunities, and then he's able to do special things. And what makes him for me even more special is that in the first hour you thought like, oh, now before we scored the 1-1, you thought like, he's not playing his best game today. And then come up with a half hour or 35 minutes, I don't know how long it was afterwards, with assists, two goals, having a shot on the bar, being a constant threat. That is something not many players can do if they've played the first hour like he did. So that is also what makes him special, apart from, if you just look at the goals, his finish is so clinical. It's special player, but that's what we all know.
A special player, but that's what we all know. And I mean, last night, David, I probably can't even come up with the words, but two goals and that assist, he was absolutely brilliant again, wasn't he?
Yeah, just unplayable. I mean, he's the one I kind of felt most sorry for at the end, that goal kind of goes in as an equaliser, because he had put on a match-winning performance that got undermined by it. So that was such a shame, really, because as Slot said, kind of, in that first half, really, couldn't really get him into the game. And when he did have it, it wasn't kind of that influential. But he just turned it on second half. I mean, it is unplayable form, world-class, arguably best player in the world at the moment. And I mean, he's on to 13 goals and 8 assists in the Premier League so far this season.
Yeah, just 14.
From 14 games, it's absolutely insane. And I tell you what, there's a lot of good things that Slot has done so far at Liverpool, but he seems to be even getting even more out of Mo Salah, which he didn't really think was possible So that's unbelievable, really. And yeah, he was just world class second half. He took Newcastle apart basically on his own, didn't he? And yeah, it's just a shame that didn't win 3 points. But again, that kind of world class quality is the difference between Liverpool getting 0 points and getting 1 point. So it's a point closer to where Liverpool want to be at the end of the season. So it's not without its value whatsoever. But it would have been nice if that would have won the game. But yeah, either way, he's an absolute freak of a player and a complete joy to watch.
Yeah, I think I'd have to have him as the best in the world right now. Everyone talks about Haaland as a pure goal scorer. If anyone's noticed, he's overtaken Haaland in the Premier League stats and put over, you know, double figures of assists up there as well. So absolutely brilliant. No two ways about it.
Sorry, just to come in on that, that's Haaland as well with 12 goals and just a one assist in the Premier League so far this season. So that is the difference. He's just the complete threat, isn't he? And, you know, he can be the one who finishes it off, but he can set them up just as well. And I thought the one he does tee up for Curtis Jones is such a good ball to like squeeze it through that gap, and Curtis just has to run onto it and hit it. And then we saw his assist for Gakpo at the weekend as well against City. He's just, out of this world at the moment. And if he stays in this form, Liverpool aren't going to lose many games this season at all, because they're guaranteed to score them because he creates and he scores. He's, ridiculous form at the moment.
Yeah, as long as he stays on this personal mission, everyone is happy at the moment. And we shouldn't miss out this player, because we talked about Salah's assist there. Trent, obviously, we wanted him starting, but they're managing his fitness carefully, comes on and he makes the two goals for Salah. It's a part of the game-changing element for us, wasn't he?
Yeah, I thought it was not just the assists as well. I thought, you know, Liverpool's improvement in build-up was a big part of Trent coming on, and he really changed that. They just looked that they were kind of short in the first half, didn't they, in terms of progressing the play. As I said, Gravenberch kept getting caught. And one way out of that trap would have been if they'd have been able to use the right-back who's usually there to get them up the pitch. But obviously what they were doing instead is they had to keep going to Gravenberch, because ultimately, you know, you've got Quanta at right back, who's a bit of a dead end in terms of progression. I mean, he's not a bad passer of the ball at all, but he's more used to the angles that he gets in a central position. Whereas at right back, it's kind of closed down for him and he can only go inside. And so, you know, Newcastle were using that, and it is kind of discomfort at being out there. So that was a big change into the second half. His Trent was big for that. I mean, 5 passes into the final third, I think he makes, which, you know, just shows how helpful. And then when he gets in those areas as well, he's so creative, isn't he? So, I totally get why he didn't start the game, by the way. And again, that's one of the reasons I think, you know, you can say about Liverpool's performance, he just would have been better if he'd started. But this is the situation they're in. They can't risk him. You know, he's just back from a muscle injury. We know you can have recurrence of those. They've got to take care of him. So I'm kind of glad that they didn't use him in this one and got away with it to the degree of getting a point, I suppose. But he's so crucial and good that he's back in it. And yeah, I think he just showed he changed the game completely. And but for that mistake at the end, he would have won it. So he'll absolutely, you hope now, be ready to start the next few in a row, and that he's kind of over that injury, and which is good news for Liverpool and kind of eases the concerns around those positions.
Definitely. And you know, he'll absolutely be bang up for the next one, which we'll be talking about shortly as well. And it would be remiss of us to kind of ignore everything that happened last night, because I mean, it's unusual for a start for Liverpool to concede 3 goals. How many games that's taken in the Premier League to get there? I suppose, in simple terms, David, was the one part at any time you think where Quanta's struggling at right back, just switch him and Gomez over. They seem more natural in those positions. And in fact, it kind of got ignored a bit that it won't be a game Quanta looks back on with great favour, but he actually looked better when he moved to centre-back with those changes as well. Were you surprised Slot didn't do the switch over at any time?
Yeah, I guess why he's doing it is because he wants to keep that consistent partnership between Gomez and Van Dijk and kind of build that up and get them back used to playing together. So, I guess I understand why he's doing it, because he doesn't want to disrupt in two positions. But I think for me, I actually didn't think Quanta did too bad defensively in the game. I know he got some criticism, but I thought even at right back, he was fine there. His biggest problem was on the ball and progressing it. I just think he looked kind of... just look really uncomfortable in certain positions that he's not used to taking up. So, That was his biggest problem. And I just thought Joe Gomez didn't have a very good game full stop. So I think even if he was at right back, maybe he would have struggled a little bit. So, but I see what you mean. It kind of, you know, felt like it took away from both of them really in terms of where, you know, it probably, if he'd had his time again, would slot have changed it. I'm not really sure, but yeah, it's a tough one with that. But yeah, I didn't think either were kind of fantastic. But again, you know, I just still think some of that mitigation is there in terms of, you know, the weather, the Newcastle energy. They've got so many runners of high quality who'll get in behind to those spaces. You know, Anthony Gordon operates over there. You see Isak wants to run into that channel quite a lot. So they had a lot to do and it was kind of difficult for them. But, you know, I just think sometimes these things are going to happen. You're going to have games like this where, you know, it's difficult or whatever, and you've got runners going in behind you and your midfield aren't offering much protection or putting sufficient pressure on the ball, so you constantly look like you're getting caught out. And so I thought a lot of it was kind of systemic, as well as kind of Gomez not having his best game and Quansah looking uncomfortable on that right side. But again, it's just one of those. I've seen so many good performances from both that I'm just kind of willing to write that off and say that this doesn't, it doesn't massively concern me. I don't think they'll be like that in the next game. You know, you saw Quansah come on against City and completely shut them out. I thought Gomez was fantastic against City. So, you know, performances like that can happen. And yeah, it's quite easy for me to kind of write that one off and just say it was a really tough evening, which it was.
Yeah, no two ways about it. And probably one player who I do feel for, because you know Quíven Kelleher will be absolutely gutted in that changing room later on, because he gets Joe Gomez out of jail big time, doesn't he, against Anthony Gordon with that one-on-one save. And I've no doubt he's probably just replaying that cross and thinking, why didn't I just tip it out, do something with it? It just happens, though. And by the way, Shaw probably only scores that one time out of 100 from that angle as well, doesn't he?
Yeah, it's absolutely outrageous finish. Fair play to him, like, and that's it. It's one of those you can just get away with those sometimes, can't you? And nobody ever talks about it again. Mm. I did think Kelleher kind of struggled all game, really. I mean, there is that save, as you say, when Gomez makes the error and Gordon gets in behind. But I think if Kelleher kind of looks back at the other two goals, I think he probably has some regrets. He looks a bit planted for the Isak one. It's a phenomenal strike, don't get me wrong. But when it goes in, you immediately think, would Alisson have saved that, maybe? You know, just not used to him getting beat from that sort of distance. So, you know, and he, like I say, he looked at it planted when the strike was taken, as good a hit as it was. And Christ, we can't take away from that. And then the one that Gordon does score, it's not a great shot. It's a weak one. It squeezes past him. I think he'll be a little bit disappointed with that one as well. But again... he's been so good in this run, and sometimes your players aren't going to play at the best. And, you know, Kelleher's probably not going to consistently over a season play at the level of the best goalkeeper in the world, but he's still an unbelievable goalkeeper and one who I think could be playing for a top club, because there's no shame in not being Alisson. He's you know, ridiculous. So, I thought he didn't have a fantastic game, to be honest, even aside from that mistake, which was, as you mentioned, very unfortunate to be punished. But again, it's one of those. And if you kind of, your right back's not playing at his absolute best, your centre half isn't, and your goalkeeper's maybe not digging them out of holes, and kind of what was happening in midfield in front of them wasn't great, you're going to have problems, particularly against a very good team and a good atmosphere and difficult conditions. So that kind of added up to Liverpool not being as solid as they have been. But as I say, you can just kind of look at this as kind of a one-off, and it's not been a consistent theme this season. You're gonna have games where you don't play particularly well, and you've got to kind of accept that. I didn't think Quíven had his best performance yesterday. I will say that.
Yeah, absolutely. It will be interesting to see how long for Alisson. It is back at the same time as well, and this player, the frustration last night with Darwin Núñez from a lot of fans was evident. And I'll be honest, I can kind of see why. I don't, funnily enough, I don't actually blame him, because people are putting it at that missed chance. I actually thought Cody Gakpo should have just headed it into an empty net, and I don't think he could reach it full stretch. So I'm not blaming him for that. However, the link-up play, the shot that he misses as well, did this feel almost reminiscent of that Bologna game? Maybe a bit worse even.
he completed more passes than in the Bologna game. I think he's around sort of 66%, which I think Bologna is 33% or something like that. So there's an improvement there. But he wasn't very good, was he? I think the thing that he's been doing better is the build-up has been much sharper recently. His pressing's been fantastic. And he hasn't been missing chances because he hasn't really been given chances. Yeah. So he kind of took that negative side of his game away. But what we saw yesterday was the build-up wasn't great. He still pressed really, really hard, but you know, build-up wasn't great. And then he did get chances and he missed them in a game where Liverpool dropped points. And I just think with Nunes, I've kind of been in this camp for a while, really. You know, he has shown some improvement and I think the manager's getting the most out of him at the moment. But it's been obvious for ages now, hasn't it, that he's not going to be a long-term option for Liverpool at centre-forward. And, you know, if he's happy being backup, then maybe he does stick around a little bit longer. But I just wouldn't be massively surprised if he comes to the end of this season and he's sold, because I think he'll want to play regularly and he can go and do that elsewhere. And he just wouldn't have if Jota was fit. And, you know, he's just not a good tactical fit for Liverpool. But I also just don't think he's of the level. He's just not of the level necessary. This is a club that, you know, recently Firmino is the starting number nine. I think Jota is of the level to play number nine for this club. I just don't think Darwin Nunes is. But I still think they can get a tune out of him this year and get enough out of him to go and win the league. Absolutely. And he can score goals for them and he can have some really good performances, which I think he has in this run. But he's not of that level. And you know, I just think it's fine to kind of accept that. We've had loads of time to have a look at him and we can say that pretty confidently now. But like I say, the job at the moment is to get as much as you can out of him between now and the end of the season, when he probably will be moved on, I would expect. And I think that what you can get out of him is enough to be the backup striker who plays a lot of games and maybe hopefully scores a few goals between now and the end of the season. And that can still be enough to get you to the biggest trophy. So, you know, he's performed that role fine so far. But I think that inconsistency is always going to plague him because that is kind of his level. He is up and down. And I thought yesterday was just one of his more down games. And I did think he played really poorly. But, you know, I also don't expect consistent world-class performance from him because we've never seen that.
Is it fair to say, because we've talked about this before, about the importance of what slots got out a supporting cast. We can include Darwin Nunes in that supporting cast, can't we? Like a Kelleher, like a Tsimikas. If everyone's fit, Darwin Nunes is most likely not going to be playing. But there has been games when he's come in, he's had a real impact, and no one doubts it. His work, his effort, his application, anything like that, and he runs his heart out for the team. It's just that ultimately he's probably never going to be the starter that we need for various reasons, but he can be a valuable supporting cast member, can't he?
That's it. That's all he has to be for this season, really, is that, you know, we kind of have to accept he's not going to be the world-class striker that Liverpool wanted when they signed him. But he can play. He's basically played an awful lot of games in this run that Liverpool have won and won and won. You know, so he's facilitating the team winning and putting the work rate in that's needed. He's been helpful in build-up. He's getting into positions where, you know, it kind of leaves the space for Mo Salah to score the goals and the other wingers have been scoring as well. So he is doing a job for the team and that's all you can kind of ask of him at the moment. And I think that is his job between now and the end of the season, really, is to keep doing that as much as possible. But in terms of what his long-term future is at Liverpool, I think we just can clearly see it now. There isn't even a debate about it that he's long-term good enough to be Liverpool's starting centre-forward. Anyone who still thinks that, I just I don't want to be too harsh, but, you know, you question the football knowledge there because it's just blindingly obvious that he isn't of that level that Liverpool need. But he can be really, really useful between now and the end of the season. He can score some goals. He can be a really important backup. And as you say, Slot's done really well at getting a tune out of that supporting cast, and Nunes is one of them, and he's going to be very important between now and the end of the season. And so, you know, it's important he has kind of fewer of those performances like we saw at Newcastle.
Yeah, and the sample size, we've got 2.5, nearly 3 seasons, and there's plenty there of evidence. It is what it is a little bit. One person that united the Liverpool fan base was Andy Madley. And I've got to be honest when I ask you about this. I think the only thing he seemed to get right for me, I didn't think that Alexis shot on Dan Byrne was a penalty. If it hit the other arm, it would have been, because that's well out the body, I think. But, you know, it's an arm tucked in. I thought he got that right, to be honest. But he seemed yellow card happy. And the other thing I'd put to you is he seemed a bit inconsistent because Joe Linton was walking around smashing people and getting away with it left, right and centre last night. What did you make of his performance?
Yeah, very poor. I just think one of those where they get very easily influenced by the home crowd, really. And you could kind of see that in the yellow cards that were getting dished out, really. I mean, how many? I think Liverpool end up with 5 or 6 yellow cards.
Yeah.
And Newcastle get 2, one of which is Nick Pope complaining about the whistle being blown after the full-time whistle. So in play, really, that Newcastle only got kind of 1 yellow card when it was just kind of one of those games where, you know, and Newcastle were the ones being kind of, and not in a bad way, this is not in a bad way, but the side that was being more aggressive, you know, and ratting around to try and win the ball, they would surely be the side who were more likely to pick up the yellow cards, and yet Liverpool got absolutely loads, some of which were fully deserved, by the way. But I thought the McAllister one, so early in the game, is so soft. That's just not a yellow. I was amazed when the card came out. That one really surprised me. So, yeah, I didn't think he was fantastic. You know, I suppose one thing Liverpool fans might want to be grateful for is the penalty not being given on Isak. I think that could have easily been given, to be honest. So maybe we shouldn't probably complain about the ref too much. But I didn't think he had a great control of the game, to be honest. And, you know, in that atmosphere, he kind of seemed to get swallowed up by it. But apparently Newcastle fans weren't very happy with him either, which, so maybe we were wrong about it. Maybe he was very good and he was balanced for both sides.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe the one thing that sort of brings together both sets of fans, who knows? So, yeah, literally a lot to be positive about, some disappointments, but we move on to the next one and we move on very quickly. And about other stuff, David, I know we're going to do your favourite topic now, but there's no escape in this, is there? Because there's been a couple of big stories galore I want to put to you. So probably the main headline that we can't time Monday's pod right, because whenever we do it, there's always a story that usually breaks either early or late, whenever it is. But pretty much we finish and then an hour or two later, there's that big story in the Athletic that Salah negotiating, and also the big headline, as you know, he would take a 1-year extension. What did you make of that headline and where it's maybe originated, the sort of the motivation behind that even?
Yeah, so, I mean, it's quite clearly come from Salah's side of things, hasn't it? That story that would make accept a 1-year deal. And I've seen a lot of responses to that. It's kind of a no-brainer. But what I found interesting, the most interesting line for me was that almost, and I can't remember exactly how it was worded, but it was an intimation that essentially would want a pay bump, which I think would be a bit of a problem for Liverpool, because that then, you know, he's already on, I mean, it's base 350 grand a week, isn't it? But with all bonuses included, he's earning sort of closer to 500 grand a week. So if he wants a pay bump on that, you can understand that's ridiculous money, isn't it? You can understand why Liverpool might be a little bit wary, and, you know, particularly if they want a 2-year deal. If it was 2 years on the same terms or whatever, I think that would get done, no problems. But I think if he wants a pay bump, we don't have a good idea of what that would look like, how much it would be. You know, and so any concerns they have over a drop off coming next season or season after that, they're exacerbated then because the pay bump's there. So it's even more money that they'd be paying out. And for a player who, you know, they would argue it's kind of unlikely to produce at the same level for the next 2 seasons solidly. So, yeah, I just think it's a tough decision. And I think you've got to always take every kind of story from both sides with a pinch of salt, although Liverpool aren't really stating their case at all at the moment. But you've got to kind of, you know, we don't know every detail and you know, that Salah willingness to take a 1-year deal, it's kind of on the surface, you'd be like, yeah, well, it's absolutely, you've got to get it done. But if it's up for absolutely crazy money that we don't know what those figures are, we've no idea what he's asking for, then, you know, you can understand Liverpool's reticence, but we don't know that detail because it's not useful for Salah for that detail to be out there. So it's, you know, we're kind of operating blind in trying to assess this sort of stuff. But yeah, it was an interesting line. And yeah, again, he's trying everything, isn't he, to get this deal done. So again, he, you know, that willingness to compromise is there on his side. So we hope that is helpful.
Yeah. I mean, we'll never know fully what's going on behind the scenes, the exact figures involved. It's just understandable that Liverpool fans are looking at a player that is responsible for 77% of the goals we've scored that got us top this season. And as we said fairly as well, probably whether on form or you see it as a whole, the best player in the world right now as well. So everyone's just wanting to see that get done as quickly as possible. And the other one, we kind of got a follow-up quite quickly over that. David Ornstein dropped a mid-morning bomb, didn't he? And he kind of covered all three. Now, I think, like you mentioned, the devil was in the detail for me on this because he split the players. He said Virgil van Dijk had an offer, obviously below what they expected, still talking. Mo Salah expected to be an offer in the near future. And then Trent was kind of, they're still talking, no mention of an offer whatsoever. Did you kind of see that as a... And obviously, being respectful, David Ornstein's well-known, well-respected in the industry. Did you see that as any more of a story or all part of the sort of dance of the whole thing as well?
Yeah, I mean, it gives us a small insight into kind of where they're up to with the three. It's interesting to know that Virgil had finally had an offer and it turned it down. So I suppose that makes you feel the further down the line with that one. And again, we sort of spoke about that one, didn't we, as one of the ones that... probably the easiest of the three to get done, or the one you'd expect to be most straightforward. So it kind of tallies with that, I suppose. But yeah, I guess just gives us a little snapshot of kind of what stage all this is up to and that they are progressing, that things are getting done. That is probably nice to know that if people were getting concerned that no offers had been made or, you know, weren't anywhere near. So yeah, I suppose we're getting every little beat of this process, and we're learning every little aspect that's going on. I would love just to hear about it when it was done, to be honest, but, you know, we are where we are. But it's just another story, isn't it, building around that. And the one reason I kind of just want these to get done one way or another is just I can't bear to read about them anymore. There should be more focus on the football and the position Liverpool are in, the job that Arne Slot is doing, the football Salah's playing outside of his contract. I wish there was a little bit more focus on that, but it is what it is. And yeah, hopefully these updates that we've got show that they're getting a little bit closer to finally getting these sealed.
Yeah, definitely. And it's kind of contract related, but I wanted to play you the clip that Arne Slot, I know you were there at the press conference anyway, but it's more just for the people that haven't seen. Arne Slot did get asked the question about January specifically. So let's see what he said in detail.
We are having discussions every day, no matter if there's a window coming up or not. So we always talk about the team, which players we like, which players are maybe not in the best place. Fortunately, we talk more about the ones that do well, because almost all of them do really well. It is a bit of a worry that three defenders are out at the moment. But the good thing is, if the windows opens, the defenders are back. So I've said many times in the beginning of this season, I'm so happy with the squad we are having. And that's not to say if there will be a chance in the market, this club has always shown that they are going for it. That's also what we did with the goalkeeper, which is not even with us at the moment, but we felt it was a chance for us to do it. So that is where this club is known for, and these people like Richard and Michael Edwards are known for. But we are mainly focused now on Newcastle, on Everton, and all these nine games that are coming up.
Interesting. And I'm really seeing mixed reaction to this. I'm seeing people like, there is hope there, there's a real chance. I've also seen like, no, that's just like this summer, we're going to sign no one. Even maybe a more moderate, like, it's going to be opportunistic style as well. You were in the room. What did you take from what Arne Slot said?
I just don't think you can read that much into it. Ultimately, and this is always how it's going to work, if Liverpool see a player is available who can improve their squad, they will go for them. If you know, everything is lined up for that to happen in terms of, do you think the value is there? Do you think the player is good enough to make a difference? The player wants to come, then they'll go and do it. And it's literally as simple as that. It's the same approach they've had in every window under FSG. If Zubimendi said he wanted to come in January, they would go for it. If not, have they sourced an alternative who they think is good enough? Are they available? Is their club willing to sell? You know, that's how they operate. So, I think it would be foolish to go either way on this in terms of saying Liverpool aren't going to make a signing in January, or Liverpool are definitely going to make a signing in January. If that right player is available in the position where they feel that they can strengthen and they feel that they need something more, then they will go for it. It's literally as simple as that. And I think Slot is basically running that line of not ruling anything out, but not ruling anything in either, and kind of just seeing what's out there, and those conversations are ongoing. So, you know, I absolutely, I think I've been consistent on this in saying that there is a chance of Liverpool making a sign in there, but it's we have to see whether that player is available, and it's very, very hard to know that.
Yeah, fingers crossed there is activity. And there you go. We love Lynch. If I can be supposed to him, I dig it. There you go. Popular even on the outfits there as well. I mean, we've talked about this to death. We both love a midfielder. We both said before it would make a huge difference, we think. And I think even last night, Ryan Gravenberch looked a bit tired. You just thought an extra body would have made such a huge difference. To go a different way this time, because he talked about, I love my squad, but Endo didn't get a single minute last night where you thought maybe if any time we could do with someone who can, you know, put the foot in, you know, a physical element there as well. Tyler Morton the same. Is there any part of you is thinking that Liverpool might just be, no, we're shutting shop that way. We're not going to let people out the squad because of how we're fighting on all these fronts where we are. Do you think that will play a part despite if these players want to go or not?
Yeah, I don't expect an Endo sale to be sanctioned unless someone were to come in. Absolutely, because even if the manager doesn't kind of trust him in that sense and he wasn't bringing him on yesterday, you still need him around for the League Cup games. You can't be a body short there. You can't afford to use one of these central midfielders. But I do think it's so clear that it's an area that Liverpool could strengthen. And you know, they've had time now to kind of identify other players, or, you know, it's the key question, isn't it? It's kind of, do you kind of go with what you have between now and the end of the season? And, you know, if Zubimendi tells you he's willing to come in the summer and they think he's perfect, there's nothing they could do that would have been better for the squad than that, do you just hang on and wait? Or take that risk of, like, you know, kind of driving Gravenberch into the ground a little bit. But, he's still young. He can get through this season. We've got midfielders who have to play a lot of games. That's just genuinely how it goes. That's the key question there. We don't know what that Zubimendi answer is, if he's even going to be available next summer, whether Liverpool have any guarantees that he will come to them or anything like that. It's a really tough one. But I think I can absolutely confidently say that they wouldn't let an Endo go now in the January that's coming up unless they were to get a replacement there in midfield. And that's not because the manager loves him. It's not because he's going to play a lot of minutes. It's because that those League Cup games are there, the FA Cup games, where they absolutely have to rest Gravenberch at the moment and he can't afford to use him. And they are games of lesser importance. So, yeah, I think they'll keep those players around if with the feeling that they need them for the less important games, not because necessarily they're going to get used. But it does just show you midfield is an area where they clearly need another body who he trusts.
Yeah, it just feels like it would make such a huge difference. And as you said, there's reward to it if it works, but there's a big risk by not bringing someone in January as well. So we'll see what happens as that develops. But in the short term, there is a massive game on Saturday, the 12:30 kickoff across Stanley Park at Goodison. I mean, this is always a huge game anyway. It's the derby, the bragging rights, everything that goes into that. After last night, where we are in the table, sort of the whole backstory to this, does it feel even bigger somehow Saturday?
Yeah, I think. Look, if you come away from this week with 4 points, that's not too bad at all. I think you're kind of happy with that, and you say that's a good week's work, really, from two tough away games. Ending up with the point at Newcastle, it won't feel too bad if you follow it up by winning to Everton. And the fact is, this, in theory, is a much less difficult away game. I know it's Everton and Liverpool have struggled there down the years, but in terms of the quality of the two sides, this should be much more straightforward. This is a much more winnable game. And so Liverpool should be going there thinking that they should do that. I mean, they could have beat Newcastle and they were unfortunate not to in the end, but also probably maybe a bit fortunate to still be in it at that point and still in front. So, you know, and you can kind of take that to come away from the point. So it would make that point much better if Liverpool go and win it. And obviously Everton have picked up a little bit of form there, but I would also say that they scored 4 goals from 1xG yesterday against Wolves, so it's hardly like they're absolutely flying. I think they just got a bit of variance in the favour in that game, so it's a game that Liverpool can win and should win, and it'll make the Newcastle draw better. And I also think it's really important that he go there, and this is an area that Slot shows he can kind of improve on Jurgen Klopp, because I thought Klopp was he just didn't do very well in these games at Goodison Park, generally speaking. Obviously, two wins, one of them a bit of a thumping win, but the other one, it's that lucky one they get at the end, isn't it, for where Mane taps it in. So generally not played very well in these games. And I think it's time for Liverpool to go there and dominate the ball and look dangerous and not be kind of get dragged down to Everton's level or get involved in that physical battle. You know, I want to see more from Liverpool in this game. And if they do win, it does. It feels like a good week off the back of a very big week prior to that. And then you think you're kind of back on track and massive favourites for the title again. Well, the massive favourites anyway, but yeah.
Yeah, everything seems right again, so to speak. And probably helped a little bit by the fact that Everton, unlike Newcastle, are not having that rest. They are literally playing Wednesday and then going into it Saturday morning like us. So hopefully that plays a factor. Lineup-wise, I mean, we know McAllister's out. And in fact, Alexis McAllister suspended for this game. I think he's suspended for Girona. So he does get a little bit of a break, whether wanted or not, naturally. Are you expecting much rotation? Are you thinking that, look, I'm looking at the players we're coming on, like Trent, Diaz, Szoboszlai, natural to come in there?
Yeah, absolutely. You'll definitely see those three start, I would say. I think the big question is kind of, alongside who? So in that attack, you know, does he just go with Diaz up front again? You know, I think the manager seems like someone who really likes to kind of pick on form, and I think he will have that Nunes performance in the back of his mind and probably won't go with him again, whereas I think Jürgen maybe would have to try and get a better performance out of him. So I wouldn't be shocked at all to see that. And obviously, midfield three kind of picks itself now because McAllister's suspended. He can keep his feet up for a week, which is nice for him. And you know what? Maybe that's not a bad thing as well. You know, every player needs a rest, and sometimes this one's going to be enforced. He's going to get a week off now. I don't think it's the worst thing in the world for him if Liverpool can get through these games. And I also think there's a chance for rotation against Girona anyway. You know, I think Liverpool have got a chance to kind of mix it up there. I would certainly like to see that, to be honest. So, yeah, I think there's going to be a few enforced changes. Not an awful lot Liverpool can do at the back except bring Trent in, but that already makes them better as well. So, yeah, it should be kind of a stronger looking side we see, I think, from the start of this game. And a game that Liverpool are much more likely to win anyway. So I just want to see the performance match that and put this Newcastle result to bed and the performance in general. Get back on track. And then if you know, get a decent win in the derby, still 7 points clear, then everybody's kind of happy again. And also it kind of, it's the game that starts the weekend as well. So, you know, you get the points on board early, just piles that little bit of pressure on Arsenal, doesn't it, to go and get the job done in their game. So that's always helpful.
Yeah, definitely. And then we can just watch and not worry too much. So fingers crossed that is the case. And there we are, ladies and gents. Hopefully that felt cathartic talking about Newcastle. Hopefully we're feeling a bit buoyant with the derby coming up on Saturday. So as ever, all it leaves me to say, David, for the time, the insight and the answers, it's much appreciated.
No, thanks for having me. I do want to just say to everyone, you know, don't feel too downbeat about being 7 points clear in the Premier League title race after playing a game at a very good Newcastle side away from home who took a lot of scalps. You know, I think people should just be a bit more relaxed and hopefully go into Saturday and get a win. And hopefully that'll cheer everybody up.
Yeah, there's a lot more twists and turns, no doubt. But there we are, ladies and gents. On the 5th of December, that was another Media Matters Anfield Index.